from the furthest reaches of the internet. This is Via Obscura Radio.
Hello, and welcome to Via Obscura Radio, a voice of the distant right and platform for exploring new and neglected ideas. Here at Via Obscura, we ask questions unasked by the modern academy and listen to voices unsupported by the mainstream media to find ideas that can lead us forward. I'm Dave from the YouTube channel The Distributist, and joining me again is James from the YouTube channel Royal Endeavor.
How are you tonight, Dave?
Great. Well, we are coming right down the line to Christmas, and you'd think that the political scene might quiet down a little bit, but it doesn't look like we're really getting that. I don't need to really mention any of the stuff going on in America with Trump. But one thing that's been in the news recently, this week, I guess, something that sort of surprised me, and something I'm not so sure exactly what to make of it, has been these recent protests in Paris. I don't know if you've seen this in the news.
Yeah, it's been all over the news, and we've been discussing it on social media quite extensively. So yeah, it's been big news.
Perhaps you can like explain a little bit about it. I have to confess not being incredibly knowledgeable about the protests and their possible implications.
So as I understand it, the protests were kicked off by a hike in fuel taxes in France that the government wanted to tax gasoline. They wanted to raise the taxes on gasoline. And the relevance of yellow jackets is that in France, I believe it's mandatory for drivers to have a safety vest in their car. And the protest is that they're wearing the safety vests that are found in their car to protest the fuel tax hikes. And it does seem like it's taken on a life of its own in many ways, in that it does seem to be like it's about more than just the fuel tax. It just seems to be a discontent with the status quo as it is right now from both the left and the right. And what it really seems to be is people coming together and really just voicing their displeasure with Emmanuel Macron in particular, but with the establishment as a whole.
Yeah, it's interesting because this seems to be very much a bourgeoisie type protest from what I have seen about it. The protest is over taxes, and it seems, and I'm not so sure this is accurate, because to be quite honest, if you looked at CNN, I think that you see very, very little coverage of this stuff going on. If you look at BBC, you see surprisingly little coverage of it. But it seems to be that these protests have rolled into a number of middle-class problems with the establishment rule.
Yes, and I believe that Macron's approval rating is in the tanks. I think that he has below 20%, and that was before the protests had kicked off, and I'd imagine that it's gone down since then. And I do think that from our standpoint, it's good that people are dissatisfied with the status quo, because I feel that the powers that be right now aren't really providing people any answers. People aren't happy with the way that things are going, and I think that they're going to be more willing to accept alternatives as that goes forward. And the alternative, at least in Europe right now, is these nationalist parties. Like in the previous French election, Marine Le Pen came in second. The AfD has been popular in Germany. And actually, there's this new Spanish political party in Spain, which is left-wing dominated, called the Vox Party, which is a nationalist party. They're still small, but they've made unprecedented gains in the past few weeks in a local election, I believe it was. So it's definitely encouraging to see that these nationalist parties are picking up steam, and that that people, especially in Europe right now, are not content with the status quo as it is.
Well, as you know, I'm much more of a skeptic of nationalist parties than you tend to be, but there seems to be sort of this thing. From what I've heard, the government's ready to make concessions. It's ready to perhaps backpedal on the tax it proposed. But I don't think that's what people are really upset about. I think that if what comes out of this is a concession or a new entitlement or a new tax policy. I think that people want something that's more radical or a bigger change, a change in direction.
Yeah, yes, because I do think that it is kind of a protest against the establishment. And really, I find that the establishment just constantly has to justify its view of the world. And it's really hard to do that. I mean, you know, they can tell us all along that, you know, globalization, that globalism, it's great for the economy. It's great for, creating like economic growth. But then, you know, when the average person isn't seeing this improvement, when the average person is not seeing an improvement in their wages, in their cost of living is increasing, and in this case, their fuel taxes are going up, you know, it's a lot harder for them to justify the direction that they're taking their countries in. And I think that that's when people will start to look for alternatives.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, there's another thing. This could be less of a change concerning, you know, historically, when we look back on this particular instance, the Yellow Jackets and all this could be less the removal of a government, because I don't think there's anyone really waiting to replace Macron who's ready to take the country in a radically different direction. I mean, you know, if Macron resigns, his party will essentially assign someone new to the position, and they're certainly not going to put Le Pen in power or anyone else radical like that. So I don't know if anything political is really going to ultimately come out of this, but what might be historically relevant is this is a shift in political protest away from the standard kind of more entitlements, less entitlement protest, and back to this is about the middle class fighting with the elites. This is about who pays the price tag for globalization and whether Western middle classes can be just fleeced to pay for globalist projects.
And it's definitely good that this discontent's coming now, because the other big thing in the news right now is the UN Migration Pact, which this has been extremely controversial. I've discussed this on Red Ice TV. I was on there last week. It's been all over YouTube. Center, right-wingers, nationalists have been discussing this thing. It's basically what it entails is it makes migration makes migration easier. So it mandates that, or at least it provides a legal framework that will make what would be illegal immigration a lot easier. And not only does it do that, it also provides a legal framework to impose hate speech laws, which would censor people's ability to voice their opposition to illegal immigration. And I mean, there's nothing good about this pact. I think it's a disaster, and I really hope it doesn't pass. One thing that is encouraging is that more and more countries seem to be dropping out of it. The United States said they won't sign. Australia said they won't. Hungary, Poland, some of the countries in the Baltics. There's no way that Canada won't sign it, unfortunately. But we have our politician, Maxime Bernier, who just started his own populist party called the People's Party of Canada. He voiced his opposition to the pact in Parliament. So there does seem to be a pushback against this pact, and it does seem to be picking up steam, which I think is very good. The discontent with the establishment, it's coming at a good time for many of these countries when they're trying to push through this UN Migration Pact.
Well, I don't know. I think the test for this is not necessarily going to be whether the countries sign the pact, but if any of these elements of the pact are going to be legally enforced or become law. Because, you know, quite frankly, the UN stuff, it does matter in a big way because it tends to become law, but it only matters to the extent that the country is signing it actually implement it. But I think the real test for this kind of policy, and you know, this policy exists implicitly in places like California, is if the places that follow this model for running societies, they could just become totally ungovernable. They could become totally separated societies with no middle classes, with constant protests, with no societal cohesion. And I don't know really what comes out of that reality. I've heard that the Yellow Jacket protests have spread to other countries in Europe that are more under the EU, more under the EU direction. But it's still, you know, aside from just creating a situation that's very, very uncomfortable for the powers that be, it's difficult to see what the ultimate plan is. I guess the ultimate plan might be just to show that you can't run a country this way.
Yeah, I definitely hope that they don't have the ability to go through with this plan, because I mean, when I listen to a lot of when I listen to a lot of these politicians that are pushing this speak, it really just doesn't give you a good sense for the future. I mean, one example was that in Italy, their minister Salvini, what he had said was that Italy doesn't need to take migrants; they need to raise their own birth rates. And I forget who it was, but there was someone on a panel with them that essentially mocked the idea of Italy wanting to maintain its own population through natural growth. And an example from Canada is that they're really pushing hard on the we have a low birth rate, we have an aging population, and we need to bring in migrants to solve that. And they really don't seem interested in policing the borders. And then, funny enough, I'll hear this on CBC, but then a day later they'll release another news story saying that, well, the way to fight climate change is to not have children. Well, apparently we need to bring in migrants to replace our aging population, but then we also shouldn't have children to replace that aging population. I mean, it really makes you think where the loyalties of the people running these countries lie.
It's interesting, on CNN, it was on one of the mainstream publications, there was a headline entitled Japan's Population Bomb. Now, people remember who are much older than me might remember that this was the title of a alarmist book about overpopulation from the late 70s. But this article was saying that the population bomb was the fact that the Japanese didn't have enough children and that they needed to import people from the third world in order to make up the difference. So what we're talking about is, as you point out, it's a totally schizophrenic approach to managing a population and managing it in a sustainable way. It's odd. This used to be sort of a fringe opinion on the side of ruling elites. Now it seems to be almost de rigueur.
Yeah, it does seem like they're going to try to justify the same things that they're in Japan and possibly South Korea also within the next few decades. And I hope that doesn't happen. But yeah, they do seem to. The sense that I get is that they don't know what they're talking about, because they'll give you one message out of one side of their mouth and then another message out of the other side. So
there's an opportunity, since essentially the progressive movement has internationalized and has been international for almost 60 years at this stage. There's an opportunity to try to internationalize a counter-progressive or traditionalist movement. I don't know what this will look like, but it will start by finding out the commonalities between people who don't like the establishment in countries like France and unifying them with people who don't like the establishment in countries like the United States. I think there's a lot to be said about this entire project, and I don't think anyone is really... Well, I should say this. I think the ground is just being broken. We're just trying to find out what the possibilities are for a true international right.
Yeah, it does seem that we see that the right seems to be pushing in one direction. I mean, there's plenty of different factions to it. There's plenty of different motivations for that. But things like Brexit, things like Trump, and then all these nationalist parties in Europe, it does seem to be pushing. It seems to be a pushback against the decisions that have been made for the last, 20, 30 years, and the direction that they said our countries are going to go. It just does seem to be a general pushback against that. And, I think things like the Yellow Jackets, it's a sign of pushback against the establishment.
Yeah. I mean, we'll see what ultimately happens. I know that you interviewed somebody who has tight connections to France in the last week.
Yes. I interviewed Paul from the YouTube channel, Paul Talk. He's an artist, and he's been an artist for several decades now, and he specializes in classical art. He has he's spent his career fighting against abstract art and modern art, which he doesn't consider to be art at all. And he's really what his channel is for is to explain his thoughts, explain what he does in relation to art, and just his thoughts on the world. He makes political videos. He's done a lot of talking about Jordan Peterson. I've had several conversations with him before, and he's in France right now, and he's been commenting on the Yellow Jacket protests.
It's interesting to see that. I think usually if you were to mention an artist in France, any time before very recently, I'm sure people would have the image of someone who's very much on the left. But it seemed that Paul had very much opinions that would be, well, I'm not so sure if they would be new right, but they definitely were more of the Straussian conservative variety.
Yes, Paul's actually been an artist for over 40 years now, and we often talk about on the right kind of the need for culture. We can address these problems all day long, but if you're actually going to influence people, culture is often a lot more powerful at influencing people than arguments may be. And Paul's a creator, and he's been fighting the fight against modernity for a lot longer than we have. So I think he's an interesting guy, and I think we had a good interview together. Hello. So tonight I'm speaking with Paul from the YouTube channel Paul Talk. He's a painter and he has had a long history with art, a long history with classical art, and a long struggle against modern art, which he's spent a lot of his career fighting against. So how are you doing tonight, Paul?
Well, I'm okay, in spite of all my battle scars from my battle with modern art.
Good. I'm glad to have you on. And I guess I'll start by saying, how did you begin your art career? What got you started in it?
Well, very traditionally, because my father is an artist. So I grew up and surrounded by that. And I always wanted to be a painter ever since I was very small. I grew up in the 60s with a few memories even from the 50s. It was a time when already what's called contemporary art started to take over. And when I was young, I saw, I sensed, well, nobody told me about it, but I could see that painters like my father and other painters who were expressionists were pushed aside by contemporary art. But I think this is something people don't understand. So maybe I should give a little sketch of what modernism in art is.
Yes.
In the 19th century, there was a movement that's regarded as a kind of progress forward with art. And people think of the Impressionists, and this is this new thing that's happening against some kind of stuffy old painting. And so that got, and it got wilder and wilder, and pretty soon people were making abstract paintings, and then it just kept going from there. And that's what people call modernism. But the story is really much more complicated, because what I ended up discovering is that, in fact, modernism began as a reactionary movement. It was a movement started by people like Puvis de Chavannes and Manet and Degas and people like that, who wanted to get serious about painting again, because painting had become a little bit non-serious. And they went back to the older artists. They went back to the 17th century in particular. They went back to Poussin. They went back to the Venetians and the Spanish painters. And they wanted to be more serious about painting. And this then gave rise to all sorts of interesting movements, which we understand it as modernism. But in a way, something even something like Cubism and Fauvism have elements, important elements of this reactionary movement in them. So it's very mixed up. And there's a whole complicated story of how ideology got involved with that, particularly communist propaganda. And then in the 60s, along came contemporary art, what is we now call contemporary art. And at that point, I think one could say, or I say anyway, that art ended. That was it. I mean, art education, normal art education stopped. And art became a kind of free-for-all where anything could be labeled art and promoted, and it would be some kind of prestigious thing.
Were you just naturally attracted to the classics, or was it really that something in particular that attracted you to classic art?
When I was young, and my father did a lot of things. He was basically an expressionist. Everybody was an expressionist back then. And what that meant was that painting was representational, but it was very free and kind of splashy. The painting I knew in particular, that of my father and his friends, was serious painting in a way. So that for me, there was a continuum between that kind of painting. You can look up some of these guys, a guy like Robert De Risto or a guy like Herbert Katzman or a guy like Gandy Brody. You can look up their painting, and there's a continuum with that kind of painting and traditional painting. So I didn't really see a big difference. And I didn't, when I was young, I didn't understand the old masters very much because I was completely surrounded by painting. And I discovered the old masters slowly, but I grew up with the emergence of contemporary art because I was born in 56. So this stuff started coming out, you know, in 63, 64, and I was a little kid, except that I went to a school right where all the galleries were on Madison Avenue. Back then, the hip galleries were on Madison Avenue. They moved down to 57th Street, and even later they went down to Soho, and now God knows where they are. But at that time, everything was happening on Madison Avenue, and my school was right there. And at that period, you know, the early 60s, even though New York was more dangerous than it is today, kids could just roam around, and I did. And I would go to the galleries, and I saw all this stuff, and I didn't realize until much later that I'd experienced something that practically nobody my age experienced, which was the emergence of these art movements and so on. And to me, it was amusing. I didn't take it seriously as a kid, but it was amusing. And later, I saw that it took over. But meanwhile, I was on my own path. I mean, maybe I suspect now that I was a little bit autistic. I was a little bit in my own bubble. But I, for instance, to give an example, when I was about 15, I discovered Watteau. And Watteau, you know Watteau? He's a very famous 18th century French painter who had a tremendous influence on French painting. And but at that time in the 60s, I mean, nobody cared about Watteau. He was known as, you know, one of the old masters. And so, but nobody cared about that. But I, the museum was there. I spent a lot of time in the museum, and I finally stumbled on this painting that hit me, and that was it. That got me going on the old masters, and then I discovered other old masters, and that was it. I mean, I didn't have a minute for contemporary art after really discovering that sort of stuff.
Yeah. And what is it about contemporary art that you really despise? Why is it that you hate contemporary art so much?
What I object to is that this is stuff that's calling itself art that isn't art. That's the problem. And the other problem is that if it tried to exist without calling itself art, it couldn't exist. In other words, it's all about pretense. This has to do with Nietzsche and everything, because the idea is that you have to be a creator. You've got to create something new. The artist became the ultimate thing in prestige, you know, because they're creative. They're like God. And everybody wants to be like God and be creative and do something original. You have to prove you're creative, you have to do something original. So people started doing these weird things and labeling them art. I mean, that's why Duchamp is so important, because there was that famous interview. I don't know if you know about that.
No.
Duchamp, who's Marcel Duchamp, has become the god of contemporary art because he did the famous urinal. You know about that?
Yeah, I know about that one.
Okay, so he did this urinal, and you know, he just bought a urinal and signed it, not with his own name. He signed it R. Mutt, and he put it in this show. And then people asked him, well, you know, this isn't art, and you know, what makes you say that? You know, first of all, you know, who are you? What is this? How can you say you're an artist? And he said, I'm an artist because I say I'm an artist. And you know, and then they said, well, but this isn't art. And he says, yes, it's art because I'm an artist and I say it's art. And people take this as a carte blanche for doing any damn thing and labeling it art. And this all comes out of Nietzsche and so on. The thing about, but there's a lot to say about Marcel Duchamp, but you have to understand that it was a whole different world back then. And what he was doing had a certain kind of meaning at the time.
And do you think that one of the problems is just lack of standards? Because, you know, what I think is that if you have the standard that anything is art, then there's really no incentive to actually create anything beautiful, because it's so much easier to just get a urinal and sign it than it is to actually put the effort into creating a real work of art.
Absolutely. That's the whole trick of it. no standards. And you're even art education. I mean, you've probably heard people saying, oh, well, you know, you can't study art because if you do, you'll cripple your mind with these rules. You have to be free. You know, you've probably heard that. That's everywhere. And that's been what people have been learning and hearing for decades and decades. It even started up when I was a kid. And you were supposed to be free and express your personality. So, and that was the big thing.
And was that the main justification that the art establishment used to push modern art?
I wouldn't put the blame on the art establishment. The art establishment just follows what's going on. The establishment was always slow to accept anything because they're always, you know, they always want to be where the money is and where the prestige is. So it took a while for people like Andy Warhol and so on to break in. But then when they saw, it's like the Beatles. You know, when people saw that they could make millions with the Beatles, then they ran after the Beatles. It just became bigger and bigger because people jump on this bandwagon or any kind of fad. I blame the artists more than the establishment. The establishment always behaves the same way. They protect whatever is successful, whatever is popular. To me, the great criminals in this case are the so-called artists. In fact, it's not artists. It's people who want to get famous and have prestige on the cheap. And Picasso is responsible in some ways for that also, because he did that. I'm not making an outright condemnation of Picasso, but there's an aspect of Picasso where he was trying to do something that would astonish people and surprise people, and not all of his work is sincere. And that's a problem. I mean, he's not the only one, but he was a very, very big influence all through the middle of the 20th century.
So when you got started with painting classical art, how did you fit into the trend that art was going on when you got into it?
I didn't. I went to four different art schools and I dropped out of them all. And I had all kinds of nasty experiences. I mean, not everybody was mean, but I had some pretty nasty experiences. And I had some good experiences too, but it was very tricky and I was very, very isolated. So it was a very lonely road, because also it's really hard to learn how to paint properly. They used to say, you know, back in, say, the 18th century, that it took 10 years to make a painter. Now it's like becoming a brain surgeon or something. It was always understood that painting properly was something that was very, very difficult. It took a great deal of training. And when I came along, I was lucky. I had some particularly good teachers. I think I had the best possible training you could gotten at that time. But even that wasn't nearly enough. I mean, I'm still doing it. I'm still struggling to make up for that lack, because there's no proper education and there's no support for the thing. You know, so it's a terrible struggle. And then something that happened was that classical realism came along. There's this new classical movement. You're aware of that, maybe.
I think I've heard of it, yes.
It's called classical realism. It has other names now. You know, they call it the new realism. And I know some of these people. Their idea is that painting is all about making good reproductions of things. You know, painting things so they look like the things. And the thing about that is that it's part of painting, but it's not all of painting. And so they start schools, and after a couple of years, anybody can learn to do this really well. But it's not real painting. It's really a sort of contemporary art in a way. I thought that I could be allies with these people because they were against contemporary art and supposedly interested in tradition. But their idea of tradition is way too limited. So that's been another difficulty. Well, they regard me as some sort of modernist painter, which I am in a way. But the modernism I follow is the reactionary modernism of the 19th century.
What to you makes good art? What would you say your standard for art is?
That's a big question. My YouTube channel is essentially dedicated to that problem. You have to learn how to really draw, and really proper drawing is not about making things look realistic. And then you have to learn the principles of painting. And the principles of painting have to do in part with what people now call abstraction. It's quite complicated. You have to accumulate a bunch of skills which at the beginning have nothing to do with each other. And you've got to be able to put these things together. I mean, some people have a tremendous talent and a tremendous feeling for it, and they can do this more easily. You know, I guess my talent was, you know, kind of average, and my feeling for it is what it is, but it's a huge thing. People think of painting as, you know, this thing you can do, you can just, you're inspired and you express yourself. Well, that's a part of it. There's some of that in it. That aspect of painting, just being inspired and following your feelings and so on, that can be useful once you have an idea of what you're doing. Then you can let it happen a little bit. But you could call it a science in a way.
It's something that's difficult to put into words.
Yeah. I mean, you can talk about different aspects of it. And I've done, I don't know how many hours of YouTube yakking about different aspects of this thing. But you have to consider, you know, there's the whole problem of how colors should be handled, the different, you know, just on and on and on. It's painting. You talk about painting. Because this business of art, I don't like the word art anymore. You know, I like to talk about painting or about sculpture or about drawing. And that doesn't mean that other things can't be artistic. And one thing I guess I would say is that art really isn't about aesthetics. When people think it's about aesthetics and just making things beautiful, it's about more than that. And in a way, aesthetics is a different question, because beauty is everywhere and in everything, and there's design and all sorts of things and wonderful things. And if painting gets reduced to that, it's not that. Painting is its own problem. Painting and sculpture come out of drawing. I mean, drawing is the real basic thing, drawing. And that's something that just isn't taught anymore. They, you know, they have drawing courses, but I've never seen any drawing courses that I would call a real drawing course.
How would you describe the state of the art world today?
It doesn't exist. There are probably now more people who are artists, in quotes, than have ever died who are artists. There's probably 10 times more artists now than there have ever been real painters who have died in the whole history of humanity. There's a new museum of contemporary art that pops up somewhere every week, and galleries and all these people and all this going on. Some of it, I mean, even a lot of it, I mean, these people aren't necessarily without talent. The things they do, you know, these fancy, weird objects, they can be full of poetry, and, you know, they mix photography with this and that, and all this. And it can be aesthetic, it can be ridiculous, but it's, I mean, but a lot of the famous stuff, you know, Jeff Koons, for instance, it's even disgusting. So it's this crazy world that is churning around with millions and millions and billions of dollars, and that commands still, for some reason, this tremendous prestige because how philosophy has, you know, with Nietzsche and everything, has turned into this business where the artist has this tremendous prestige and creativity has all this importance. On and on, originality. And so it's this great institution that's churning around that has absolutely nothing to do with drawing and painting and sculpture. It's a carnival that is all about itself.
It's a free-for-all.
It's a free-for-all about pretense and money.
You can put the label artist on anyone, but that doesn't necessarily make them good at art.
Absolutely. And that's what you can do now. I mean, everybody's a creator. Everybody and anybody's a creator. And you can't do that with engineering. You know, the bridge has to hold up. when the cars drive over it, the bridge cannot collapse. So that keeps people, you know, they remain more sensible when that comes. But art, it doesn't matter. If painting doesn't exist, it doesn't matter. Nobody suffers. There's no disaster except a cultural disaster.
Do you feel that the decline in art and with contemporary art, do you think that says something bigger about our society as a whole?
Oh, yeah. To me, that's what got me into philosophy, because I realized that this was really crazy. And of course, what happened was when it's a big story, and I suppose we shouldn't go into all that. But what happened as modernism developed, and because the artists were all communists, the idea of communism is that history progresses, and history has a certain shape, and it's going to a certain goal. And the goal politically is the dictatorship of the proletariat. So the artists felt that they should have a goal and they should get to the essence. You know, the essence of politics is to arrive at complete equality and complete justice and so on. And so the painters got this idea in their head that essence of painting was abstraction. In other words, just colors and lines thrown around. Get rid of representation, you understand? And so they were doing this abstract work. And if you were doing representative work, you were accused of being in the trash can of history. You were accused of being irrelevant. you couldn't do realistic work, couldn't do representative painting and be taken seriously. In the 60s and the 70s, that was very, very strong. And you have to be my age to have lived through that. But it was nasty. It was really nasty.
Would you say that your political views influenced your art, or did art influence your political views, would you say?
Art influenced my political views, because I asked myself very seriously the question. It's like the Jordan Peterson's thing. You should, you know, you have to really ask yourself questions and not just assume. So I would say, well, look, maybe these people are right. Maybe what I'm doing has no historical relevance. And then I had to figure out why the heck they were saying such a weird thing. Because, you know, when I walked into the museum and I saw Watteau, that was part of my present, as far as I was concerned. It seemed miraculous to me and wonderful, but there it was. You know, it's part of what I'm living now. So that's what drove me to philosophy. I was lucky to have an uncle who was a student of Leo Strauss. And so I got some philosophical training, and I studied on my own. That's why I got into philosophy. And getting into philosophy is what got me into politics, because when I was a kid, I wasn't political at all. I mean, the situation of our society and our world was not what it is today. I mean, in the 60s, if you were a Canadian or an American, the whole world is America and everything's fine. That was the feeling. And there was just, you know, everything was fine. And now we live in a world where we're very conscious of the rest of the world and what's happening. Americans can no longer so easily look at the rest of the world as sort of a vacation place or some kind of extension of America. And there's all this communication and all this immigration and all this multiculturalism, and our society itself is breaking down from the interior. So now we're more conscious of those things. But artistically, these things happened in the 60s. They happened in the 50s and 60s. So the culture and society is now where painting was 50 years ago. Because in art, that could happen without consequences.
And so you describe yourself as a conservative individual.
I'm a defender of tradition. Let's put it that way. I mean, okay. I'm not a blinker defender of tradition, but I read this terrific thing in Taine the other day. It talks about how there was this idea that if you get rid of your prejudices, that equals intelligent. Not being prejudiced equals intelligent. But the thing is that these prejudices might be smarter than anything you can figure out yourself. You might not be able to understand the prejudice, but it might be the world is so big and so mysterious. My feeling is one has to be very, very careful before making changes. You know, if it's not broke, don't fix it, kind of thing.
And I think that kind of plays into one of the major problems that we really have had in the West in the last maybe you could even say since the Enlightenment. It's kind of the idea that you have to constantly critique something. You have to constantly break something down. You got to find a flaw in it. And it seems to be that the path that we followed is that if we can find any flaw in our traditions, in our values, in the structure of our society, then we must discard it because it's irrelevant. But the problem is we don't really have anything to replace it with.
Yeah, absolutely. But the thing is that you can't just throw out the idea of criticism. You can't just throw out the idea of improvement. In other words, it's like a fire. You have to constantly tend it.
The problem is it's criticism, but without any solution. So, you know, you can tear something down, but you have to be able to build something up that's better.
It's also a constant work that has to be maintained. It's like having a house. If you have a big house, it's always falling apart. You always have to be fixing the roof or replacing the windows or painting it or making some renovation that you got to have, or, you know, or like taking care of yourself. We have to eat, we have to exercise, and then you grow old and you've got to adjust. You know, you can't exercise in the same way, you can't eat in the same way, you can't, you know. So the thing has to be tended. And our society and culture and art and everything, new pressures are going to happen. For instance, globalization, it's a new pressure. So the Cold War comes to an end. America wins the Cold War. And what happens then? Well, then suddenly the world is freer, and so people can trade. And so then people start exploiting this possibility in good ways and bad ways. But that the condition of the end of the Cold War and the beginning of globalization is a kind of neutral thing. I mean, it can be abused, but it's good in some ways. or good. It's what it is. And you have to cope with it, and you have to cope with it intelligently. And people just rush into these things with the idea of making money and gaining prestige and so on, and they create a lot of damage.
And do you think that in relation to, say, modern art and really just the entire state of modernity, do you think that it's really kind of the decline is the result of a lack of something?
Well, a lack of respect, a lack of appreciation of the things we have. Yeah. A lack of reflection and understanding, you know, stupidity. And in a way, the new stupidity is caused by the new conditions. So these things feed on each other. But at the same time, without throwing the baby out with the bathwater, my life was saved by modern medical technology. I mean, I would have been dead if I'd been born 20 years earlier.
One of the real dilemmas we face is that technologically we do keep getting better. And I guess you could say if you put quality of life, the quality of life index, it seems to keep being up and up and up. I mean, I don't know how long that's going to last.
Say up and up and up, but I would say more and more powerful.
Yes.
And power is neutral. So for instance, we can talk to each other with this incredible internet. At the same time, Facebook or YouTube's going to shut us down because of the bad things we're saying.
Yeah.
So,
but I feel though that the West has lost a lot of the more abstract cultural things that really kind of made it such an impressive civilization. When I think about art, and I think about, you know, wider history, the last 1,000 years or so, most of art in the West was inspired by Christianity. It was inspired by religion. And do you think that a big contributor to the decline in art and the bringing about contemporary art is the loss of religion?
That probably contributes, but to the problem of painting, it probably contributes indirectly. Because there were great painters who weren't very religious. I don't think being religious as such, painting it's like technology. It's a techne, it's an art. And you can be a horrible person and create great art. But if you live in a society where art doesn't even exist anymore, then there's no art. I mean, but this is the lesson of Tocqueville, you know, de Tocqueville, who said that American democracy is wonderful and there's all these great things and there's all this freedom and there's all this possibility and therefore there's all this prosperity and so on. But he said it depends on people being religious because it depends on everybody playing by the rules and being good. And the system, the American system, for instance, the Constitution, it's not that makes people good. They're good because they're good people. You know, they're good because they're religious believers and they're behaving each other and they're monitoring each other. And so when we lost our wonderful religion, the best religion that there ever was, then the society goes off the rails because of the loss of morality. Because the religion isn't morality, but religion supports morality. So yeah, I would agree with that.
And I do think that kind of the lack of standards, it's something that you can also see in other aspects of contemporary Western society. Like what I often talk about is architecture, and I'm not an expert in architecture. I don't have a background in it. I just see some of these major cities. I see that they really all become the same. So like, for example, the city that I'm from, Toronto, there are parts of the city, there's old parts of the city where you can see the old Victorian era. And it once was a very beautiful city. It once had a very unique and very beautiful aesthetic, but that's all been overgrown with, you know, these modern giant piles of glass and steel.
Yeah, it's horrible. And this comes, but the history of contemporary architecture is well known. It comes out of communism played a big role in the Bauhaus and all that. The idea was that things should be, you know, all this aesthetic frilly stuff was seen as peripheral, seen as bourgeois and ridiculous. And what we need is housing for the workers. And what the workers need is hot water and shelter. And they don't need all this crap and worship of technology. And worship, therefore, of numbers and getting things all clean and clean looking and geometric without any humanity or warmth to it. And if you read Ruskin talks a lot about architecture. And to him, it was interesting to read Ruskin on architecture because to him, architecture comes out of sculpture. The decoration and the sculptural aspect of these buildings is what determines the buildings themselves. It's pretty interesting to read. And then if you read, for instance, Palladio or Vesuvius, it's the same thing. Everything comes out of these architectural orders. In other words, art was the thing that, it's so backwards from what we think of today. I mean, now we think of decoration as, well, okay, you have a structure and then you plaster decorations over. But the old way of thinking about architecture was you had an artistic proposition and then the structure arose out of that. I mean, it's something that has to be gone into very deeply, and it's a way of thinking that's totally alien to us. But you get a taste of that in Ruskin. But we're just out of that. We're into this technology thing, and this aesthetic, all this aesthetic. So we have this clean aesthetic. Really, talking about it to you now, saying these things, I realize how alien the spirit of those beautiful buildings is to us now. I mean, it's, you know, and when people try to do it in postmodernism, they try to do it. You know, so they stick on a fronton or some, you know, they stick on some decoration to their box, because basically all architects can come up with is a box or a weirdly shaped box like Frank Gehry. He uses these shell shapes and stuff, but basically it's just still conceived of as a box. That's horrible.
There's a building in Toronto, which it's the Royal Ontario Museum. And I've used this picture a lot in many of my videos because mm-hmm. I find it's just so symbolic of kind of what has happened to Canadian culture, but I think Western culture is total.
Yeah.
What the building pretty much is an old, either Victorian or Edwardian building. It was built over 100 years ago, the museum. And it's a beautiful building. It's one of the last remaining things of old Toronto. But they built this postmodern shape on the side of it, and it cut right through the building. And there's just such a lack of care, just such a lack of standards.
It's the same thing of riding on the prestige of the past. There's some beautiful thing that was made, and they do an irreverent thing. And then they take credit for having done something, you know, beyond what these actual artists did. It's very sad. It's childish, really.
I think another problem, though, is the over-intellectualization of things like art and architecture. Like, I often think of the Cathedral of Christ the Savior in Moscow, in Russia. It was the biggest Orthodox cathedral in the world. It was built in 1862. It was built to thank Christ for Russia's victory over Napoleon during the Napoleonic Wars. And it was just a spectacle. But after the Russian Revolution in the 1930s, they really only just saw this big waste of money, the communists. They only just saw this big thing that was apparently oppressive, a waste of money. Why did they spend all this money on building this cathedral? And when you break it down to just the material, it wasn't good for the economy. It didn't help your material wealth to have that cathedral, but it was one of the most beautiful cathedrals in the world, and the communists demolished it in 1932. All that art was lost, but after the fall of communism in 2000, the Cathedral of Christ the Savior was rebuilt, and again today it is the biggest Orthodox church in the world. But what got me about that story is that when you do break everything down to just its material, the material value of something, beauty doesn't make sense. You can't put it into numbers. You can't put it onto a sheet. You can't judge it scientifically. It's something a bit more abstract.
Communism is the concentrated essence of all this modern philosophy, you know, starting up in the 18th century, if you like, even before. And it's a total disaster, a total disaster that's completely destructive and ugly. And we're still fighting it. Even though communism has been defeated, it's still in everybody's heads and all these intellectualized notions about equality and on and on and on. And it's a disaster. And our world is suffering more and more ruin from it. I mean, the horrors that communism committed upon the beauty of the world are just too numerous to mention. But we're still in it, thinking this very cold, intellectualized, idealized way, which leaves out of life these other aspects that are crucial. It just doesn't work. We have heads, but we have hearts and we have bodies, and all these things have to be taken into account. And we also have our society, our history, our traditions, which maybe can be improved or criticized and so on. But it's just terrible what we've been through here.
Yeah. And when I think, communism, Marxism, the idea that it was founded on was equality. The real driving force was the drive for equality. Whenever you listen to a politician speak today, they talk about freedom, equality, all this jazz. And one thing I often try to analyze on my channel and trying to look into this a bit more is, what does the idea of equality push people to do? What does it really inspire in people? And, you know, one of the struggles that I've come across, and it's similar to probably what you faced with the contemporary artist saying that you're kind of just getting in the way of progress. This is the way it's going. You're just holding it back. I think one of the things that I've encountered is, you know, I often talk about the kind of a need for a culture, a need for more belonging in your own nation, your own neighborhood, your own community, a need for purpose and stuff like that. And one of the critiques that I often get is people saying, well, why should we care about that? That's just kind of old think. But the problem is, though, that when you look at human nature and when you look at the way that societies have been run in the past and in the present, people crave these things. People crave meaning. They crave belonging, and they crave a culture and to be part of something that's bigger than them. And it's kind of this like nihilistic destruction of that, that it has really just kind of been used to write it all off.
Look at it this way. If, let's say, something bad happened, suddenly there was no more electricity, no more gasoline, suddenly water supply went wrong, suddenly everybody would be looking to everybody else for help. And suddenly everybody would be forced to cooperate and work together. So in a way, and when you do things like that, you know, it's well known. You've never probably heard of Abbé Pierre, who was a priest in France. And Abbé Pierre did something.
No, I haven't.
He started this movement in France, which was a very terrific thing. And his idea was, I mean, this is something that you can encounter in lots of ways. But his idea was, he wanted to help the homeless and he wanted to help the bums, is what he wanted to help. And he got the bums together, and he got them, instead of trying to be helped by other people, he got them to help other people. And this thing he started, I mean, he's a wild character. It's not like he's some kind of perfect saint or anything, but he did this very interesting thing, and he got people helping each other. When you're busy helping people, when you're busy doing things for other people, you tend to be happier. You know, you're not thinking about your own problems. You're thinking about somebody else's problems. You get out of yourself. And when we live in a world that's so rich, where if you don't have any money, if you can't make any money, they give you money. Nobody has any problems in a way, because we're so rich and we're so powerful. So then what do? Well, then you're free. You're free to do all kinds of things, whatever it is, take drugs or play video games or, you know, or do good things, whatever they are. So there's this tension. You know, if we're forced, you know, people who live through wars and so on, like I knew a lot of people in France, for instance, who lived through the war. My wife lived through the war. And there was a lot of happiness at that time in a certain way. I mean, people were terrified and these bad things happened. But because there was a lot of togetherness, people were forced to do all these things. And you can find that in any kind of situation. You know, people become nostalgic for these rough things they've been through because brought them together with other people and got them out of themselves. You know, we want this freedom. We don't want to be living in war or in terrible circumstances. But once we get out of those circumstances, then we've got this wonderful freedom and we start doing stupid things that are selfish, and we make ourselves unhappy. So it's a kind of permanent human dilemma that's brought on us by our prosperity and our power, and we're not dealing with it very well. How do you stay virtuous when you're so powerful and so prosperous, and you have everything you need, and everyone can live as a monad? You don't need your family. You can travel somewhere else. You can, you know, there's all this freedom and all this power. How do you deal with it? And it's a real problem, because a lot of people, you know, this is something Aristotle points out. A lot of people they don't have what it takes to be responsible for themselves. It's like this business of IQs below 85. And these people with IQs below 85, they need somebody to direct them. Because otherwise, you know, I don't know, they'd sit there staring at a wall or, I don't know, walk into a hole or something.
Yeah. I think, though, that another problem that we're facing is moral relativism standards. It's that, you know, people are free, but they don't have any morality. And that freedom really just means freedom from responsibility. And, you know, it really is a destructive force because, you know, is someone free to leave their wife and kids and go off and marry a younger woman and become like transgendered and get a sex change and all this stuff? And
that comes out of the whole modern philosophical thing. And, the essence of modern philosophy is Machiavelli. And what is that essence? That good and evil don't exist.
Yes, someone is technically free to just sit at home and play video games all day. They're free to get addicted to pornography. I find there's a big problem in defining freedom as that and defining that as a moral good. Because the idea that the ancients had was that freedom was overcoming those desires. It was being able to face those human impulses and be able to overcome them and to actually be a virtuous person and actually achieve something. But it's kind of been reversed that we define freedom and morality as giving into those things. And we don't have that framework anymore. And
absolutely. But I would say that in the old days, there moral relativism didn't exist. Moral relativism is not a function of freedom. It's a condition of modern philosophy. It was possible for the Romans to go decadent, but they knew that they were being bad, or the majority of people knew that these decadent things were wrong, but these people were so drunk with power. So the majority of people retained these standards, even if they went, it's like Catholics. You know, the Catholic idea is that you have to go to confession all the time because you're constantly sinning. You know, you can pray, you can be good, but there's a saying in Catholicism, the greatest saint sins 7 times a day or 70 times a day or whatever it is. So we're constantly sinning, but that doesn't mean we're morally relative. That means that sin is taking us over. We have trouble knowing the right thing to do. We have trouble having the character to do the right thing. But now we're living in the situation where moral relativism has been justified by philosophy. And that creates a new problem. That problem of moral relativism, you know, relativism in general, which destroys standards, as you're pointing out, that is a great philosophical problem because the arguments in favor of moral relativism are quite convincing. I don't think they win the argument, but it's hard to fight them. And that has to be fought. I mean, that's a fight I've had all my life, just within myself. Some things are beautiful and some things are ugly. You can't say that in art. That's, you know, you can't say that. Everything's valid. Everything is, it's what it is. But no, there are things that are good and things that are bad. And moral relativism is wrong. And we have to find ways of getting out of that because it's a huge handicap and contributes. It's like a supercharger on temptation and weakness.
We often discuss online threats that we find the West facing, as in a lack of standards, a lack of just fortitude. And then things like immigration, mass immigration, Islam, the ideology that's taught in the academy, the polarization of the political sphere, and then the economy also, like the prices and all this stuff, and just how it's becoming so much more difficult to live. And, you know, with the problems in relation to many of these threats facing the West, do you think that a lot of this has been brought about by a lack of culture? Do you think that a lack of culture has really kind of made people?
Well, sure, because look, there were times when there was lots of immigration. I mean, if you look at the 19th century, you know, half of Ireland came to New York.
Yeah.
But at that time, first of all, well, the Irish were fairly close to the Americans in their approach to life and their morality. But whoever the hell they were, at that time, Americans or anybody else anywhere else, they wouldn't put up with any crap.
Oh, exactly.
You know, you conformed or, you know, get out. That was that. And today, there's no question of asking other people to reform their ways. We can't do it. And so there's things, you know, big issues, the women in burqas. Well, you know, so in France, they make a law against the burqa. And then it's a constant struggle. In the old days, I mean, you know, Arabs came to France. I mean, Arabs went everybody went everywhere in the old days, just like today, not in the same numbers, but you know, they just wouldn't do it. The social pressure was just too tremendous.
Then another one of the problems is just kind of the idea of just universalism. And France back then was for the French. And if you didn't like that, well, then you know you have to get out because
they didn't look at it quite that way. It was like if you behaved weirdly, everybody was going to pull you up short. It was like discipline for children. Now, it used to be if a child misbehaved, first of all, their parents would clamp down, but everybody would clamp down. And the parents wouldn't have any problem with everybody clamping down. I mean, there were just certain standards that you just followed. But now, you know how kids can behave now, little kids. I mean, it's horrible, bratty behavior. And nobody dares stop them, and the parents don't dare stop them. And the situation gets, I mean, you've lived through that.
Yeah.
In the past, that didn't happen. And any adult was expected to come down on bad behavior, not just of children, but of, any kind of bad behavior.
Yeah, just going back to the lack of standards that we have that, someone can come into your country and totally disrespect your laws, totally disrespect your people and your culture, and we just let them get away with it.
What goes on now is, take the example of gay pride. Now, they're everywhere. And they're pushing this onto everybody, in the name of this sort of universalism of endless progress and moral relativism and so on. This sort of philosophical soup that backs up this sort of thing, and everybody is supposed to take it lying down. And if you don't take it lying down, that's when they come at you. that's where people start having the moxie to stand up and call you a Nazi.
Yeah, and what I've said before is that this kind of worldview, it's the authoritarian enforcement of a lack of standards. It's so that, not only do we not have standards, it's mandatory that we do not have standards. The progress of history is that we get rid of all standards. And I've said before that I kind of think of pride parades or events like that stuff, undescribable stuff. Like it's the result of a society that just has no standards. But then, if you point that out, well, then you could, find yourself in a lot of trouble. Yeah. So it's not only do we not have standards, it's mandatory to not have standards.
Yeah, but it's a kind of standard. So it's a double standard.
The only standards we have are that we have no standards.
Yeah. But this problem is exacerbated by technological power. And the technological power makes travel so easy. And our notions of freedom, which is really the basis of power, because power comes from freedom. That's something that has to be faced. America is the most prosperous and powerful country in the world, not because of configuration of the land or something else. It's because of the freedom. And people are allowed to be creative and make money and build up that's the reason. And people are richer in Europe than they are in the Middle East, because even though they don't have as much freedom as they have in America, they've got a lot more freedom than they have in the Middle East, etc. So this is a problem that has to be faced. In other words, you can't just say it's our culture which has defended freedom and made us so powerful that has also put us in this situation where we have trouble defending our freedom. That's the core question that has to be faced. There's a temptation to say, well, let's just do it the way we used to do it. We can't. The situation has changed.
Yes.
We've become so powerful that we now have to find a way of dealing with our power. And in this very clumsy way, it's like all these YouTube bannings and so on. That's very stupid and so on, but it's a very clumsy, it's one more clumsy attempt to deal with the situation.
So I'll ask you one more question. Terms of a political movement, in terms of a movement that will solve these many problems that the West is facing now, that I've been discussing and many others on YouTube have been discussing and that, they've been cracking down upon, in terms of political action to actually solve that, how do you feel that art could inspire a movement like that?
Well, I don't know. I listened to a lot of your last stream, and I thought that was excellent, what you're trying to propose there of getting people away from their petty differences and recognizing errors and having better optics, as you put it. I have to say, I'm really perplexed. For a very long time, I was convinced that contemporary art would collapse of its own weight. And in 1991, there was this great crisis in contemporary art. There was a sudden huge drop in prices. And I thought it would go away because I'd been convinced all my life it couldn't go on. It just couldn't go on. It would have to stop. But no, it just keeps on going. And then governments, I know in France, they were very concerned about this, and they suddenly did all these documentaries and stuff that they put on public TV promoting contemporary art in different ways.
Do you think that if people kind of had a bigger, if people had a more of an appreciation for the culture, more of an appreciation for the values, and, you know, through something like art, do you think they'd be a lot more motivated to stand up and make a difference in the world?
James, I don't know. I mean, my feeling, my tactic about painting anyway, is that the only way to do anything about painting is to make really good paintings. You know, and I mean, I think I've made some really good paintings, but so far it hasn't done anything. But so my paintings are rejected, you know, basically, not by nice people, but my paintings should not exist because they're an affront to this thing. So, but I guess some people are interested in what I'm talking about on the on YouTube. Of course, my channel remains a very small channel. It's just the people who watch, I guess they appreciate it. But it's I'm talking about that to talk about the larger thing. I mean, something's happening. Obviously, something's happening. There are good things that are happening. I mean, there's wrong things. You can have legitimate criticisms of Trump and Brexit, but at the same time, these are hopeful things that are happening. There's a general movement that, I mean, even MGTOW and these sorts of things and anti-feminism, there's something positive in these things. They can be clumsy or they can...
The critique might be a little bit legitimate. Maybe the idea is bad, though. In terms of something like, say, MGTOW, like, you know, their ideas are, well, quite ridiculous, but, you know, you can understand why someone would kind of have that frustration with the world.
Well, right. And it's a way of sort of shaking up the paradigm, cast light on what feminism has done to society. It's true. I mean, people, bit by bit, the society is turning against feminism, I think, even though it's still so powerful. There's hopeful things going on. And I think this sort of resistance movement to everything that's happened is growing, but it's not going to be what we ideally want. And I think you're very right in what you said in your stream, that one has to try to get behind and accompany and be part of and encourage a general direction in which everything's not going to please us about it. But maybe something can be saved. Maybe the general thing can move somewhere better. I feel that that's happening, and I think your attitude is right about that. So,
well, I think this has been a great interview. Thanks for coming on, Paul. And you guys
can
you can check out his YouTube channel. He discusses art, politics, and he does a lot of great work.
So listening to your interview with Paul, I was struck that we do have to deal with something of a generational divide between different branches of conservatives. I think that people of the past generation just see the world in a different place, perhaps a more effective way of looking at the world, but one that seems to people who are millennials and younger to be a little bit rose-tinted.
Yeah, you know, Paul and I have had several discussions before. We've had a few disagreements on things here or there, but I feel though that you know, he watches a lot of videos on YouTube, and I feel that he really has kind of taken on a lot more of the positions that, you know, you and I might espouse, and he's kind of gone beyond the basic boomer conservatism, and I think he recognizes that there is a lot deeper of a problem with the West as it is today, and that a lot of that does stem from culture, and a lot of that just stems from and you know where he sees it is in modern art.
I think that's a good point, and this just shows you that I think once the channels of communication are open between the two sides, and not to be a Hegelian here, but some synthesis will arise, some way of incorporating the objections, the problems of the modern world will come about. I think you said this a little bit in a character like Trump, but there's more to be done on the intellectual side. And this is just the beginning, I think.
Yeah, I think that people on the right, they have a reason for believing what they believe. And, you know, regardless of why you came to those conclusions, I think that we need to see the value in kind of what we share in common, in that we very much want the same goals, and we kind of would like to push in this particular direction. And yeah, it's encouraging when you do see older generations of conservatives and younger generations meet on a common ground. And I feel another figure that has done that for a lot of people is Tucker Carlson. That he seems to be saying things now that Fox News really hasn't been saying forever, really. And he seems to be a voice that people are a lot more excited to listen to now than they would, say, Dennis Prager these days.
Tucker Carlson is an interesting character. I just finished his book, which is interesting. It doesn't tell you anything that you won't have already known by, say, listening to this podcast or being reasonably aware of events in America, although it's a nice encapsulation for it and maybe something you might want to give to a family member still stuck in 1980. The thing is I think Carlson does represent people slowly changing their mind, and his worldview has become more or less a synthesis of concerns both from the right and the left in the past 30 years. I find it a little bit exciting. I think there's a lot of opportunity here.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to the Yellow Jackets protest, that it does seem to be a synthesis of not really only right wing, not only left wing, but it's really just people that have just been dissatisfied with the status quo as a whole, kind of coming together and voicing that. And you know, I do hope that eventually down the road people will make that bridge that gap, because I do feel that a lot of the concerns that I have about the world, someone who would have been on the left 30 years ago might have the exact same. And I could very much see, you know, in the coming years, us being on the same side. That's very possible. And we can look at plenty of figures that have seemed to have made that change over the last couple of years.
Well, speaking of people coming together, peace in between warring parties, and of course, the constant war between global techno-capital and Christian traditionalism, Christmas is coming. And I felt that this sort of being our last episode before Christmas comes underway in full, I was just thinking, what are we looking forward to in this Christmas season? And, you know, as we try to culturally process this time of year, which is, again, supposed to be like Thanksgiving, a time of cultural reconciliation, is there anything that we learn about the culture of the modern West in general?
Well, unfortunately, Christmas does seem to be a holiday like many others that does seem to be commercial, that does seem to be extremely commercialized these days, and that, you know, maybe people might be losing that, the original purpose of Christmas, that was to celebrate the birth of Christ. You know, I just hope that it can be a time where people can put aside their differences and maybe try to be kind to one another, regardless of political alignment. And hopefully the family gatherings don't result in arguments, because that seems to be a lot more common these days.
Well, it certainly is. I have to say, I've come from a very progressive state. I was born in a very progressive state, and I've heard, wow, almost 30 years now of progressives hand-wringing over the commercialization of Christmas. And I always think it's kind of funny. They seem to want to replace the commercialization of Christmas with something. Goodwill, sort of the Hallmark vibe, perhaps sentimentality. But as we've sort of disentangled Christmas from the explicit religious holiday, all of those sort of good fluffy things have gotten a lot less prominent. And the only thing really there that's remained has been the commercialization.
It does seem to be a holiday that when people think about Christmas, the first thing that comes to their mind these days is presents. And I don't really know how you really can change that other than to actually return to what Christmas is meant to celebrate. Because I don't really think that you can, if it's not meant to celebrate, to be a Christian celebration, I don't think it can be anything other than just consumerism.
We know it's sort of funny because people always decry Christmas materialism. But sometimes I think, and I'm traveling in Eastern Europe a little bit over the holidays, and I'm thinking more and more about how abstractions really, they're very difficult for people. And what the anti-commercialization of Christmas push over the last 30 years from the left has missed is that you can't replace physical things with abstractions. And if you want people to get together for a holiday, there has to be something physical you're organizing around, whether it's a religious symbol or, well, presents and consumer goods, right? At the end of the day, human beings are physical beings, and we want to rally around something that actually is embodied.
Yeah, it is one of the few times in the year that you'll actually get large family gatherings. I mean, for me, the only really times I can think of these are Thanksgiving and Christmas. And in recent years, my family hasn't been doing Thanksgiving gatherings, so Christmas is pretty much it for the extended family very often. And it does seem like it's a shame that it's very, very difficult to actually get extended families to gather these days. And if it's over presents, then that's kind of what it's over.
I think since we're winding down the episode a little bit early this week, do you have anything that you're looking forward to? Any new projects or any personal celebrations, any family celebrations coming up during the Christmas season?
Well, yeah, I'm looking forward to the annual family celebration. And, I have a lot of family members that are extremely progressive. I have a lot that are extremely conservative, but I really don't like talking politics with my family. That's something I do not do. I'd like to maintain good relationships with them. And if I were too honest, I don't think that would last for very long. In terms of projects, I'm working on a video on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I'm looking to kind of branch out and to start talking about and try to avoid the really blackpilling issues and try to avoid the alarmism, really, because I find that it doesn't really help because, a lot of people at this point understand the problem, but solving it's not something we can do overnight. So I think, just provide what you can that's unique.
Well, I think there are way too many black pills in the internet today, way too many black pills in society at large today. But on the more white side, there's one giant Christmas controversy that I have to put towards you, Endeavor. Do you like eggnog?
Yeah, it's not bad.
Some people love this stuff. I think it's good, but I really can only have it with booze. But I have to say, that first glass, If it has the right alcohol to fat content, it's absolutely delectable.
Maybe once a year.
Yeah, exactly. Well, everyone, I just want to wish people, our listeners, a happy Advent or a good Advent and Merry Christmas when it finally comes about. There'll be a lot more live streams as Christmas approaches on my channel. I'm not so sure we're going to get to I think we might get to another Via Obscura Radio before the end of the season. At any rate, have a wonderful evening and a Merry Christmas.